But like I said, we want to help all of our viewers get a bit closer to the world of mutual funds by understanding some of the terms that appear, especially on a mutual fund fact sheet. Yes, it's quite a long statement with lots of tiny numbers and lots of tiny words, some of which you may not exactly understand because it is, of course, jargon in the world of finance. So we want to sort of introduce you to these jargons. Turnover is what we'd like to talk about today. And to help you understand that, we have Harshvardhan Roongta of Roongta Securities. Harsh, thank you so much for joining in on The Money Show. You know, I suppose many a times individuals, when you ask them, oh, why don't you invest in mutual funds? The common answer will be that, oh, you know, I don't understand finance much. I'm an engineer, or I'm a teacher, I'm a doctor, or any other excuse, right? And hence, we decided that we'll take on this these terms of sorts, you know, at least once every week to sort of explain to our viewers and, you know, ensure that they don't use this as an excuse to, you know, not invest in mutual funds. So today we thought we'll talk about turnover. Let's start off by, you know, understanding what exactly does turnover mean in the mutual fund world, Harsh.
So, well, Mubina, let's just understand what a mutual fund does. So to begin with, let's, you know, any mutual fund scheme, be it equity, be it debt, be it a hybrid, any kind of scheme has underlying assets in which they invest into. So say if you're investing in an equity fund, so you give your money in a particular fund, in a particular scheme, and that scheme goes on to buy a number of shares. So they would have probably 40 companies in which they're invested, or 50 or 70 companies in which they're investing that money. Now a turnover essentially is trying to depict to you, a turnover rate is only trying to show to you how much percentage of that holdings has changed in that portfolio in the last 1 year. So if a fund house has offered a particular scheme in which they're holding say about 40 companies, now all those 40 companies need not remain as it is at the beginning of the year and at the end of the year. So the fund manager will try and sell the companies which are not doing well and try and buy into other companies which are potentially going to give a higher return in the future. So this you know, churning of the portfolio in that sense, the changes, the buying and selling that is being happening in the investments in the portfolio that they have created is actually the turnover rate. So this only tries to depict and show that change in the percentage holding of the portfolio for the investor. So this is the turnover rate. Now the question is how important it is, how relevant it is, and whether you should, you know, the pros and cons about it. Now that's a different story altogether.
So Harsh, if I'm, you know, an individual, I mean, I'm a retail investor, I have units of certain mutual funds, and obviously I'll have 5-6 mutual funds. I won't just have one mutual fund in my portfolio. So when I open a particular mutual funds fact sheet and I see that turnover, you know, percentage, how am I supposed to read into it? I mean, is a higher number better? Is a lower number better? What exactly does it mean?
No, so, you know, just simply saying that a scheme is probably having a high turnover rate does not make that scheme bad in that sense. So let's just understand this entire concept. Now, if you're investing in an actively managed fund, so you're putting your money into a fund wherein the fund manager is going to take the call for investments, he's going to try and chase a growth story if that is the object, that is the you know, style of investing in of the scheme. So they are going to try and chase an idea which they will want to invest into, and if that does not work out, they will want to get out of it as well. Against this, if you look at a value oriented scheme, now the objective of a value oriented scheme is to buy into undervalued stocks, something that the market has not still given them the right valuation. They will buy into that and just hold on until it reaches its fair market value. So the turnover rate in a value oriented scheme will be much lesser than what it will be for a growth oriented scheme. So you know, you have to look at what exactly is the scheme objective. If the objective of the scheme is to, you know, try and, you know, generate a higher alpha, try and chase the growth story, then of course there will be slightly higher turnover, you know, that will be as compared to other schemes. So I don't think there is a fair argument to simply peg a decision on to saying whether a higher turnover rate is negative for the fund. No, but surely there is one point that investor would need to know. If there is a high turnover, so there is an incidental cost. So every time a scheme buys shares or sells shares, there is some cost that they incur. So the higher turnover rate, which means that the scheme incurs slightly higher cost than what a scheme with a lower turnover rate will be there. But if they are able to generate a higher return, you know, in lieu of that expense that they're incurring, then I think it's completely fair. Now, so to conclude this particular discussion on whether a high turnover rate is negative for the scheme. I don't think a blanket decision can be taken on that. It's a very subjective item. So you'll have to possibly look at it in relevance to what returns they have generated, why the fund manager has tried to move out of a particular company, because they might not be seeing future in that, or there could be some negative information on that particular company. So I think these are the things you'll have to keep in mind and take a very balanced view about it, rather than just, you know, simply pegging one decision on the rate itself.
Like you mentioned, Harsh, you know, when you're taking a decision on a mutual fund, I suppose you have to look at it more holistically. I mean, just, you know, looking at turnover and saying, oh, it's too high, so you're going to exit the MF is not going to be right, because in all probability, it may be having, you know, a higher return as well, because the fund manager's objective as well is to maximize the wealth that the mutual fund can sort of generate for its unit holders. And hence, he may have taken, you know, the decision to, you know, change around the constituents of the fund as well accordingly. So, Harsh, now, you know, I was talking about this in my earlier question as well. I, as a unit holder, I do have maybe 5, 6, maybe 7 funds in my portfolio for various purposes, whether it's, you know, for wealth creation, retirement, so on and so forth. Now, to actually check on a monthly basis the fact sheet, look at terms like beta, Sharpe ratio, turnover, it's a bit tasking, especially if I have another job in some other field. So, to what extent do you actually think that individuals should be looking very closely at parameters like, say, a turnover?
Well, Mubina, it's a very valid question, because, you know, we are, you know, talking about investing. So investing, irrespective of whichever profession you're pursuing, whether you have the knack of finance or not, you need to invest your money. Unlike people who are in the finance field and who need some medical help, you might not want to get into the nuances of that. Simply go to a doctor and ask for prescription. So, well, I understand the you know, the requirement to at least understand basics. But if you get into the details, so while we're talking about the education level, awareness level in financial literacy in our country, I mean, the acceptance of mutual funds and equities itself is at a very, you know, nascent stages. So get into the technical aspects of numbers and figures is something which does not really happen on a very common basis. What I would say is that, you know, one, of course, turnover, if you're talking about specifically about turnover, yes, do have a look at it. I mean, don't try, you know, you may just want to have a look at it to say how much of the portfolio, because we all the time talk about long-term investing. And if my portfolio is completely being churned around all the time, then it kind of also, you know, does not match with my larger objective. So, okay, turnover should be there, but it should not be very, very high. And you could set that parameter to say that I would want to have at least a turnover of not more than 20%. So these are things that you could evaluate and then do a comparative study as to what the industry is also doing, the peer category is doing. If this particular fund is churning around quite a bit and it's not even generating higher return, then of course you will want to move out of it. I mean, that's the only reason why you would try and look into it. If you could manage your portfolio on your own, I'm sure people would start investing into equities directly. So leave, you know, certain things to the experts in the field, which could be the fund manager. Let them, you know, try and figure out the balance, how to keep, how much to sell, how much to buy. Okay, you keep an eye into it, but don't get too much involved, because then it just puts one more leg into deciding before you invest your money. And what, you know, you're talking about all these technical aspects of the numbers, statistics and the ratios. I think that's more the job of an advisor. So if the advisors can, you know, go into those details, do the background screening and shortlist a couple of schemes which are, you know, meeting the balanced criteria all through, and then suggest an appropriate scheme for the right profile of an investor, I think the life will be much more easier. And for an investor, the less he gets into technical aspects, I think the happier he will be.
Okay. Well, you know, I suppose what Harsh is also trying to say is there's a reason you're paying a fee, a financial advisory fee to, you know, experts like Harsh Roongta himself. That's so that they can take the headache for you and that you can, you know, rest. You simply just give them the money and they'll take care of the rest, like, you know, all those jargons like turnover, Sharpe ratio. But I suppose it's still a good practice, right, to sort of be armed with knowledge like this, because the more you know, the well equipped you are as well, you know, to in turn perhaps ask questions. Okay, and speaking of asking questions, if you know, any of you guys do have any queries with respect to your portfolio, you're not sure if your portfolio is built well enough, you know, for you to be able to create wealth, call in 2499-0300 is the number that's appearing on the top of your screens, and Harsh Roongta will be here to get them answered. Well, for now, let's take on board our viewer query that we have received. It's coming. in from Shiv Kumar Burli. He writes in saying that I've built a corpus of 10 lakh rupees in HDFC Top 100 regular fund, and now he wants to switch 50% of it to the HDFC Equity Direct Growth Fund and 50% to the same Top 100 Direct Fund. So basically, he wants to move from regular, he wants to move to the direct plan, and also he wants to split it. He wants to put only half of it in the Top 100 and the other half he wants to put in the Equity Direct Growth Fund. So he wants to know if he must do this in one go or set up an STP. Now, you know, usually you do an STP when you want to move from debt to equity or something like that. But yeah, in this case, would you recommend he uses an STP? And if you could also, you know, for the benefits of all our viewers, explain what the STP procedure works like.
Well, Mubida, you're absolutely right when you said that STP essentially is used as a mechanism when you're investing your lump sum money into a debt scheme. And from there, very systematically every month, because you transfer money into an equity scheme, you're doing this for the simple reason because you do not want to take equity exposure at one shot, because markets are volatile and it does not, at most of the times, people don't have that kind of risk profile to invest the entire lump sum into market and then wait for it to go through that volatility. So the process of STP, as you asked, is very simple. That if you had, suppose, a 10 lakh of rupees lying in your bank or a fixed deposit or somewhere else, now you want to invest into equities, but you do not want to take that entire exposure at one shot. You say, I don't want to put 10 lakhs into equities because the markets may fall tomorrow or it may be volatile, I don't know. So rather invest it every small bits and over a couple of months. Now you have a choice to keep the 10 lakhs in your bank account, and you set up an SIP wherein every month a particular amount will get debited from your bank. Now, other thing is that many investors do not want to keep it in their bank because there's a tendency for it to get spent or get used for something else. So they say, I want to get rid of this money from my bank account, but I still don't want to invest in equities in lump sum. So what you do is you put this 10 lakhs into a liquid fund, and from there you give instructions to the same fund house to systematically transfer a particular amount of money every month from this liquid fund into an equity fund. So your money gets deployed in the first place. It earns a debt return that the scheme will give, a liquid fund will in this case give. And then every month a particular amount gets shifted into an equity. So you're not taking a lump sum equity exposure. Well, in the case of Mr. Shiv Kumar, he's already into an equity fund with a 10 lakh of rupees, which is built up over the years. That's what he said. So I'm assuming it's an SIP that he has done, and he's built up 10 lakhs over a period of time. So he's already averaged the market. Now, if his goal is still 4 or 5 years away from now and he does not need the money immediately, it does not make sense for him to then again average out through a process of STP. So he's very clearly shifting 50% of his money into a multi-cap of HDFC, which is an HDFC equity fund, and 50% he's keeping in the large cap fund which he has, but he's moving to a direct option. So I don't see any reason for him to, in that case, go through an STP route. He should, in fact, just simply go ahead and switch into a direct option of HDFC Top 100 itself and the multi-cap option of HDFC equity fund. Averaging has already been done. Now is the time for compounding. So just remain it, invest into equity. Do not go through the STP route.
Okay, so there's really no need to use an STP route if you're just within that equity mutual fund universe. Usually, like Harsh as well said, that it's when you want to make that transition, from debt to equity, that's when you use the STP route. Okay, Harsh, I actually had a follow-up question. In retirement as well, I do understand that the STP route is used very often. Could you explain how that as well works?
So at the time of retirement, I believe you're talking about the SWP. That's a systematic withdrawal plan. So one is an SIP, where the money is in your bank account and the fund house actually debits your bank account for a fixed amount of money every month. That is the SIP. STP, as we just spoke about, is a lump sum gets invested into a liquid fund or a debt scheme. And from there, it gets transferred systematically into an equity fund from within the fund house itself. The third is an SWP. So that's a systematic withdrawal plan. So hypothetically, you had a corpus of say 10 lakhs, 20 or 50 lakh accumulated at the time of retirement. You do not need that money at one shot. So one option would be that you remove the entire money, put in a fixed deposit, earn interest on it, or whatever for that matter. Alternatively, because you need only a small amount of money every month, you could choose a systematic withdrawal option. So your fund value, say 10 lakhs, and you require 20,000 every month, so you just instruct the fund house to now do the reverse of SIP. Well, in the case of SIP, they were debiting your bank account and investing into the scheme. Now in an SWP, a systematic withdrawal plan, they will redeem out of your fund 20,000 rupees and credit it back to your bank account. So this is a source of regular cash flow that retirees do many a times opt for, and the rest of the money which is invested continues to generate a return. So it's a very conducive environment where all kind of options are available in mutual funds, all type of schemes are available for the no risk person to somebody who's wanting to take very high risk. All kind of schemes are available, all kind of options are available in mutual funds.
All right, fair enough. That's SWP as opposed to STP. Okay, let's take on board our next query. Akshay Shiv Madan has written into us saying that he has a couple of SIPs. There's 15,000 rupees in the HDFC mid-cap opportunities, one of the biggest ones in the mid-cap space. He also has 5,000 in the ICICI Prudential. He's not mentioned which one. And in the Mirae Asset Large Cap Fund at 10,000 rupees. He wants to know if he must continue making SIPs in the HDFC mid-cap or would you recommend some other fund? Well, it's a question, Harsh, that, since you as well have been appearing on The Money Show, you've been faced with quite often that, my mid-cap is losing money. I started the SIP 2 years ago. My small cap is losing money. What should I do now, right? And interestingly, it's at this point in the markets where now people are saying that, you should take tactical exposure to mid and small cap funds. So, yeah, how would you help Akshay Madan out?
As far as I understand, the concerns Akshay has is primarily because of the returns that this mid-cap fund is giving him. So it is most certainly going to be negative as of now, or at best flattish. So if he's not incurring a loss, he's just about the cost that he's incurred and the cost of his investment. The only concern is that this is the case with all the entire mid-cap segment. So you do not single out saying that this HDFC mid-cap opportunity funds is not performing, because he might be comparing this to the large cap and the thematic scheme that he has. He has an ICICI banking and financial services fund. So he has a thematic oblique sector fund kind of a scheme in his portfolio as well. So that is why he may be feeling dejected. But my suggestion, Akshay, is HDFC mid-cap opportunities is a good fund. You have exposure to a large cap, you have a sector thematic fund in your portfolio, allocations are reasonably good. So I think you should continue with the mid cap. And as you've rightly pointed out, I mean, we have started listening to fund managers also trying to say mid cap has been beaten down quite a bit now. And the year 2020 may be the year of mid caps when they will start, coming to the fair value or generating positive returns. So I think keeping all this in mind, keeping in mind the fact that HDFC mid cap opportunity is a good fund, I would suggest Akshay to just stay invested and not to do anything right now.
Okay, stay put right now. You really don't have a lot of reasons to worry. Okay, let's move on and talk about another query we've received. Hussain Tambawala writes into us saying he started an SIP of 5,000 rupees each and now increased it to 7,500 rupees each. He wants to know if he must stop any SIP. So there are six funds in total. The Aditya Birla Sun Life Pure Value Fund, which has been going through some tough times recently. Franklin India Smaller Companies, HDFC Top 100 Fund, HDFC Small Cap Fund, L&T Mid Cap Fund, and the Mirae Asset Emerging Blue Chip Fund. I think overall his portfolio looks like it's pretty skewed towards the broader markets, the small caps and, the mid caps. Though he does have that top 100 fund, HDFC's top 100 fund as well, which you could call a large cap fund. Harsh, how would you look at his portfolio? He's unfortunately not written down any goals as such. We strongly urge all of our viewers as well that when you invest, make sure you have a financial goal in mind, be it retirement or, for your child's education, whatever it is. But let's assume that for Hussain Tambawala, it's a regular wealth creation journey that he wants to achieve via these SIPs. So, Harsh, what do you make of his portfolio?
Mubina, you're right when you said the entire portfolio looks completely inclined towards mid and small cap, barring just one scheme, which is a large cap, one which is a large mid cap. The entire portfolio otherwise seems to be completely tilted towards mid and small cap. So, there are two points to this. There is always a chance that an investor has picked up mid and small cap funds looking at some past returns. So, he may have started, say, probably a year or two ago, and he looked at only returns of the mid and small cap category was giving at that point in time. He just filled his entire portfolio with mid and small caps. The other sense is we do come across investors who want to take that kind of an excessive risk who want to take higher risk in mid and small cap very consciously. So, Mr. Hussain, in case you have constructed this portfolio consciously keeping in mind that you want to take exposure into mid and small caps, then you can continue with this portfolio. However, as a prudent investor from a long-term perspective, it is always better that you have, you know, adequate diversification across different categories. So have allocations towards large cap, towards multi caps, towards mid and small caps if you wish to have. Just that it's a better strategy from a long-term perspective. In the short term, of course, you may make or lose excess money in case you are concentrated in mid caps, but on a long-term basis, it's much better to have a balanced portfolio. So in case you wish to have the diversification, I will suggest two small changes to you. Instead of the HDFC small cap, invest into an Axis multi cap so that you will have an exposure into large, mid and small all but selectively. Instead of the L&T mid cap, you add an ICICI approved blue chip fund. So you already have an HDFC top 100. You're adding an ICICI approved blue chip fund in your portfolio. So you'll have two large caps, two mid caps, and you will have one multi cap and one large and mid cap. So this allocation becomes much better and balanced to capture the movement across the market rather than only the mid and small cap category.
All right. Okay, well, on that note, we're out of time, so we'll not be able to take any more questions. Harsh, thank you so much for joining in on this edition of The Money Show. We'll have to wrap it up. Coming up next, all the detailed analysis as soon as the advanced GDP estimate number hits your screen. Stay tuned to ET Now.